Tonight, as our children are exiting, going up to the children's church, if you got any, you can go ahead and release them if you want to, or they can stay in here, and that's fine. I heard Paisley over here singing up a storm with her mama, wasn't she? That's a good thing. Nothing wrong with that. Teach those kids when they are young. We are continuing in our series entitled Knowing God, and in this series, we've seen where God invited Abram into a personal relationship with him. Abram entered into this personal relationship, and in Genesis chapters 12 through 25, we see Abram learning all kinds of things about the character of God. Now, Abram has been in this relationship, but one thing we have seen, Abram has made a lot of mistakes. And today in Genesis chapter 16, we're going to see him make another mistake. And what this tells me is, hey, I got hope. Because Abram made so many mistakes, and you know, he's Father Abraham, so in all of my mistakes, and you in all of your mistakes, God is so patient, he keeps on working with us, and thank God for that. Now, what we're going to see today is the mistake that Abram made. It was looking and listening to someone other than God. Looking and listening to someone other than God. And it wasn't just Abram that made this mistake, but his wife Sarah made this mistake, as well as the servant Hagar made this mistake. And sadly, I bet every one of us in here have made that same mistake. Looking and listening to someone other than God, making bad decisions, which makes messes. And here's the thing at the end of the message I want us to see. The only thing that really gets us out of those messes, and it may not be out of it without consequences, but out of the mess is confession and repentance. Getting back to that state of obedience with God. So now I'm going to read the entire 16th chapter. I don't do this all the time unless I'm having to sort of bounce around in the text with the outline. So when I do this, I'd like for everybody to stand with me. I'd like for us to stand and honor the God who has given us this text from which we can learn how to have a better relationship with Him. So Genesis chapter 16, beginning in verse 16, it says, "Now Sarah, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, and she had an Egyptian maidservant whose name was Hagar. So Sarah said to Abram, 'See now, the Lord has restrained me from bearing children. Please go in to my maid. Perhaps I shall obtain children by her.' And Abram heeded the voice of Sarah. Then Sarah, Abram's wife, took Hagar, her maid, the Egyptian, and gave her to her husband Abram to be his wife after Abram had dwelt 10 years in the land of Canaan. So Abram went into Hagar, and Hagar conceived. And when Hagar saw that she had conceived, her mistress, that's Sarah, became despised in Hagar's eyes. Then Sarah said to Abram, 'My wrong be upon you. I gave my maid into your embrace, and when she saw that she had conceived, I became despised in her eyes. The Lord judge between you and me.' So Abram said to Sarah, 'Indeed, your maid is in your hand. Do to her as you please.' And when Sarah dealt harshly with her, Hagar fled from Sarah's presence. Now the angel of the Lord found Hagar by a spring of water in the wilderness, by the spring on the way to Shur. And the angel of the Lord said, 'Hagar, Sarah's maid, where have you come from and where are you going?' Hagar said, 'I am fleeing from the presence of my mistress Sarah.' And the angel of the Lord said to Hagar, 'Return to your mistress and submit yourself under her hand.' Then the angel of the Lord said to Hagar, 'I will multiply your descendants exceedingly so that they shall not be counted for multitude.' And the angel of the Lord said to Hagar, 'Behold, you are with child, and you shall bear a son, and you shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord has heard your affliction. Ishmael shall be a wild man. His hand shall be against every man, and every man's hand against him. And he shall dwell in the presence of all of his brethren.' Then Hagar called the name of the Lord who spoke to her, 'You are the God who sees.' For she said, 'I have also here seen him who sees me.' Therefore the well was called Beer Lahai-Roi. Observe, it is between Kadesh and Beren. So Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abram named his son, whom Hagar bore, Ishmael. Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore Ishmael to Abram." So God, as we look at this text today, help us see better who you are. Help us understand how we still are struggling with sin. And help us see this morning that there is a pathway to stay right with you. Help us to avoid the pathway that makes us wrong. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all. You may be seated. Now, there are three primary people I want us to see in this, plus God. There is Sarah, there is Abram, there is Hagar. And I'm going to ask a pointed question about each one of these individuals in a way that I also is asking you if you're acting like one of these three characters at this moment in your life. So the first question is, are you looking and listening to your culture? Because that's what Sarah was doing. She was looking and listening to the ancient culture in which she had been born and raised, and it was having a negative impact on her current issues. Now, four ways we see that she was looking and listening to her culture, and it was affecting her relationship with God and with others. First of all, just like with Sarah, your culture may tempt you to blame God. Notice in verse 2, it says, "The Lord has restrained me from bearing children." Now, this is what Sarah was saying to her husband Abram when she was coming to him with a proposal to overcome what she saw as her major problem, which was her inability to give birth to a child. Now, notice who she's blaming for her inability. She says, "It is the Lord who has restrained me from bearing children." Now, nowhere in the text does it say that God stopped her from having a child. What it says is that God will open her womb someday in the future, and we know Isaac will come out of Sarah's womb. But what Sarah was doing is the same thing that people today do all the time. When bad things happen, we have a tendency to blame God. For instance, today, let's say there's a woman who cannot get pregnant. She asked the question, "Why won't God let me get pregnant?" See, we do the same thing. Or let's say you got a man whose wife cheated on him, and he says, "Why did God allow her to cheat on me?" Or you've got a parent whose child is sick with leukemia or diabetes, and the parent says, "Why did God cause my child to have this disease?" Or you've got a widow whose husband died, and she says, "Why did God take my husband?" Now, I want you to notice in each of these statements, which I have heard even in the church, we are blaming God for the bad things that's happening in our lives. But the Bible makes it very clear. God does not cause the bad things to happen. It is our sin that causes bad things to happen. Before Adam and Eve ever ate of the forbidden fruit, there was nothing bad happening. It was only after sin entered into the human race that these bad things happened. So when we, like Sarah, blame God for our problems, we've got a total misunderstanding of who God is. Now, God permits bad things to happen, but He is working through the good and the bad to fulfill His ultimate will. But the bad things happen because of sin, human sin. That's the first thing we need to understand and not fall into the trap that Sarah did in her culture, nor even in our day today, even in some church cultures where people blame God for the bad things. Now, the second thing is that your culture may tempt you to contradict God, to contradict Him. Verse 2, Sarah said, "Please go in to my maid," that's Hagar, "perhaps I shall obtain children by her." Now, what Sarah is asking her husband Abram to do was something that we know was legal in that day. Archaeologists recently have uncovered what's called the Nuzu tablets, which are from basically Iraq, which was the area where Abram and Sarah once lived before they came over to Canaan. And in these tablets, we learn that if you had a couple who the wife could not get pregnant, and they had the means by which to do this, they could actually get another woman to sleep with the man, and when he gets her, this other woman, pregnant, and that woman gives birth, then that woman who was barren, who could not have children, but she's got the means to do this, she could adopt that child as her own child. Now, this was an ancient cultural practice. This is what we might say is the first recorded instance of surrogacy. A surrogate mother. And all that Sarah was doing was something that was done in the culture legally. But folks, this whole concept of this woman's husband sleeping with another woman in order to give this woman a baby, this goes against God's plan in Genesis chapter 2. But yet the culture was telling Sarah, this is acceptable. And Sarah was listening to the culture rather than listening to God. And we do that. Even in the church, sometimes we have problems arise in our lives, and we start listening to the cultural answers rather than listening to God's answers. You got business problems, so you look and see how the world gets out of the business problems. You've got problems with your dating life. You know, and whether you're young or whether you're divorced and you're dating again, you start using the world's dating methods rather than God's way of finding that spouse. You've got marriage problems, so you look to all of the psychology the world has to offer to figure out your marriage problems. Or you've got parenting problems, your kids seem out of control, and you listen to the world's solutions to your kid problem. Well, I'm here to tell you, Satan is the ruler of this world. And Satan is manipulating civilizations and culture, and everything Satan is doing is for the purpose of destroying God's relationship with people, not helping it. So when you are looking to the world's solutions for your perceived problems, it is going to make a mess of things. And that's exactly what Sarah is about to find out. She's using the world's problem. I can't have a baby, so Abram, I want you to sleep with my slave here. And when she has a baby, I'll claim that baby. Sounded logical to her in the moment, but she's about to make a huge mess. You listen to the world's answers, you're going to make a mess of your life and people around you as well. Number three, your culture may tempt you to blame others. Once you follow the world's pattern of living and you mess things up royally, then so often people today do exactly what Sarah did in her day. Look in verse 5. She told Abram, she said, my wrong be upon you. When Hagar saw that she had conceived, Sarah says, I became despised in her eyes. So Sarah is telling her husband, look, you made a mess of this. You got her pregnant, man. And I'm sure Abram is like, my goodness, I can't win for losing. All I did was what you told me to do, honey. And I can only imagine the argument that ensued that day in Abram's home. And you've got Sarah blaming Abram for that which she herself initiated. Now, don't get me wrong. Abram had enough blame in this thing as well. I'm like, you are stupid, man. You should have seen this one coming. And so he had plenty of blame. But notice, at this moment, when Sarah saw the mess that the world's pattern created in her family, what should have been her response as a godly woman? It should have been confessing, I'm following the world instead of following God, and we got to stop this. But she wasn't confessing and repenting. What was she doing? She was a blaming. And that's the natural sinful instinct, not only for ungodly people, but sinfully, that's the natural instinct for godly people. Because remember, 1 Peter chapter 3, Peter writes and says that Sarah is the holy example that Christian women ought to follow. And I'm like, but the thing is saints, I'm talking about godly people, if they take their eyes off of God's ways, quit listening to God, even the most godly people will mess things up royally as Sarah did. And then start blaming everybody else, just like the world does. Listen to the news. Anybody take responsibility for anything? No, it's the sinful human instinct to blame others. And that's what Sarah does. Number four, your culture may tempt you to attack others. Because what Sarah does is she begins to attack Hagar. Now, notice in verse 6, it says, Sarah dealt harshly with Hagar. All right, Sarah comes to Abram in verse 5 and says, Abram, you messed up everything. You slept with my slave. He's thinking, you told me to. And she says, fix this problem, because now the slave thinks she's higher and mightier than what she ought to. And in verse 4, it does tell us that Hagar actually did think that her social standing in the family had been raised because she's got in her womb the master's first child. So Hagar had a part to play in this, but Sarah is telling Abram, fix this problem, Abram, that you created by getting her pregnant. And you know, that is often the way that people are. We blame other people for the mess we make, and then we become so emotionally aroused and we just can't handle it anymore that we become people we weren't before. You know, Abram tells Sarah, when she says, you straighten this out, Abram said, You straighten it up. She's your maid. So how did Sarah do it? She dealt harshly. Now, the Hebrew word for this means she abused. And you can tell, she verbally abused Hagar. She emotionally abused Hagar. It's plenty clear. And more than likely, although we're not told specifically, she physically abused Hagar. Because that was the cultural practice at the time. Anytime there's slavery in history, you see that the master and his mistress, his wife, they would often physically abuse. Even the lady of the house would physically abuse the female and the male slaves. We see it all the way through even American history. And more than likely, Sarah was verbally and physically abusing Hagar. And I'm thinking in my mind, she may have been physically abusing Hagar the world's way, hoping that with the abuse, Hagar would miscarry. Because from a world's point of view, when you got a baby that's unwanted, what's the best way to get rid of the problem? Get rid of the baby. And that could have been very likely this godly woman's sinful response. Because why? She had been looking to the world for the answers to her perceived problems. And that's where it takes you. Places you imagine you could never go. But you look to the world for your answers and you'll go places you don't want to be. So, first of all, are you looking to the culture for your answers the way Sarah was? Now, it's easy for us to pick on Sarah, but she wasn't the only one having the problems of looking and listening to someone other than God. Abram was the same way. Now, Abram wasn't looking and listening to the culture. He was looking and listening to Sarah. And that can be just as dangerous. So I ask you a question. Number two, are you looking and listening to your family instead of looking and listening to God? Because that can be dangerous if your family's not looking and listening to God. Three things where Abram was tempted by his family, primarily Sarah. Number one, your family may tempt you to sin. Again, in verse 2, so Sarah said to Abram, please go in to my maid, perhaps I shall obtain children by her. Now, what did Abram do at this point? Wives say, well, whatever any good husband ought to do. He listened and he did what I said. No, that's what he did. Abram heeded the voice of Sarah. He did exactly what Sarah told him to do. Now, this reminds me, and it's funnier in my mind than it will be to you, because I've seen it. Bill Cosby years ago, decades ago, did a stand-up routine in which he was talking about Adam and Eve. And in this routine, he said Eve was just using and abusing Adam, saying, come here, Adam, come here, come here, come here, come here. And Adam would come and say, no, get away, get away, get away. Come here, Adam, come here, come here. No, get away, get away, all right. And then she would grab something. She'd say, here, eat this mud pie. And Adam, you know what Adam would do? He'd eat the mud pie. Here, eat this wood. Eat the bark off it. He ate it. And then she ran out of things to feed him, so she grabbed the fruit off of the tree God had said not there, and took her crunch and said, here, eat this. And what did he do? He ate it. And, of course, Bill Cosby says, that's when God whistled, said, all right, everybody out of the pool. All right? Nobody gets the punchline because I can't tell it like he did. But here's the thing. Cosby had something here. I bet Cosby didn't even know. So often men will do whatever their wives tell them to do in order to keep peace in the home, even if it goes against what God says for the man to do. God said that the men are the heads of the house, the way Christ is the head of the church. And you know what happens when people sin? They will do the opposite of what God tells them to do. Wives are told to be submissive, but yet so often in the home, wives want to guide and direct the family. Husbands should be the guiders and directors, but so often in order to keep the peace in the home, they will acquiesce or forfeit that decision-making process to their wives. That's exactly what Abram was doing here. The philosophy, you ever heard it? Happy wife, happy life. But you know what? That philosophy is rooted in looking to your family before you look to God. And that's exactly what Abram was doing. And man, I'm picking on us a little bit today because we are the spiritual leaders of the home. And if we don't lead spiritually, we are forcing our wives to make decisions that God does not intend for them to make. Not that they're inferior or anything. It's just the order God created. And here's the thing. You force your wife by forfeiting your responsibility and she makes bad decisions. She's responsible, like Sarah, for her bad decisions. But you know what? You don't escape the responsibility. You're responsible for her bad decision as well. And that's the reason to this day we're still reading about Abram when he forfeited his responsibility at this point. And notice, he heeded the voice of Sarah, which that formula should say he heeded the voice of God. So you have to be careful, men, women, you got to be careful that you don't listen and look to your family members for the answers as much as you listen and look to God for the answers. Because I see so often families get royally messed up when they look to their family members and they want to please them so much they will neglect God's word. I've seen parents who want to please their teenager so much they will give in to everything their teenager wants. But folks, I'm here to tell you, teenagers are not prepared to make those life decisions. And you give in to them, you make them rotten, and they will be rotten for the rest of their lives. I've seen grandparents who are fearful of confronting their grown children because they're fearful that their grown children will take the grandkids away from them. And I'm here to tell you, I would rather confront my grown children in obvious blatant sin than to see my grandchildren go to hell. Because more than likely, if you don't confront your grown children in the sin in which they are living, more than likely they're going to see the example of their parents in that sin and they're going to follow suit. Are you looking and listening to your family more than you're looking and listening to God? Abram was. And here's the thing. When it becomes a mess as it did in Abram's family, the next thing is your family. They're going to start blaming you. You're going to be tempted to blame yourself for this sin that they were asking for it. Look in verse 5. Sarah said to Abram, "My wrong be upon you." You know, she's just like the world. In this moment, when she's not looking to God for answers, she starts blaming Abram instead of accepting the guilt of her own sin. Now remember, I told you, Sarah was guilty. But I would contend Abram was more guilty because he kept his mouth shut when he knew what he should have done. But in this, Sarah should have confessed and repented, just as Abram should have confessed and repented, and they could get their family back on track. But that's not what either one of them did. One blamed the other, and the other overlooked the sins of the one. And that's the third thing. Your family may tempt you to overlook sin. You see, in verse 6 it says, "So Abram said to Sarah, 'Indeed, your maid is in your hand. Do to her as you please.'" Because when Sarah came to her husband and said, "Look, this little slave girl that you got pregnant, now she's all haughty with me and disrespectful. You better straighten this out, boy." And you know what Abram said? He said, "You take care of it. I'm going fishing." He didn't say fishing, but in essence, that's what he meant. You take care. I'm going to do what I'm going to do, but she's your problem. And what he did was he forfeited his spiritual headship of the home. And he overlooked sin. And you know what happens in a home when the leaders, the husband, the wife, mother's father, when they overlook sin, you know what's coming next? More sin. And that's exactly what happened. As Abram said, "You deal with it," that's when she went and dealt harshly with Hagar. She abused Hagar. Sarah's sin went from one sin to another sin to another sin. Abram's sin went from one sin to another sin to another sin. That's what happens when we overlook sin. What are you looking at helping you make life decisions right now? The culture, looking for your family to give you answers, or looking and listening to God? Now, Abram and Sarah aren't the only two that struggled with this in the text this morning. There's a third person, and that person is Hagar herself. Now, Hagar, once Abram told Sarah, "She's your problem," Hagar went and began to abuse her. Now, in the middle of the abuse, Hagar couldn't get her mind off of the authority in her life, which was Sarah. And folks, are you in a situation where you are looking and listening to the authorities around you, and you can't get your mind off of them instead of keeping your mind on God? And Hagar, she couldn't get her eyes off of Sarah. And Sarah was doing three things to her that caused Hagar to react in a way God didn't want her to react. Number one, your world's authorities may accuse you the way Sarah was accusing Hagar. Look in verse 5. "When Hagar saw that she had conceived, Sarah says, I became despised in her eyes. Sarah is accusing Hagar of being disrespectful to Sarah as the mistress of the home. And now, like I said, verse 4 tells us Hagar actually did think beyond her status in the family. She did despise. And here's the thing, lots of times when we make bad decisions, even like Hagar, we will actually do something that does provoke other people to accuse back. And in your workplace, maybe you have done some things. In your family, maybe you have done some things. And the accusations begin to come. Maybe you haven't, and the false accusations begin to come. If you live very long at all, you're going to have people making accusations against you. That is simply the way life in this fallen world happens. And this doesn't just end with accusations. Often it moves to the next level. You know, your worldly authorities then may begin to abuse you, like Sarah did with Hagar. Verse 6, when Sarah dealt harshly with Hagar. It moved from accusation to abuse. This woman that the Apostle Peter says is the holy example for all of you ladies to follow, who we have a hard time believing she would never be emotionally and physically abusive to someone else. But I'm telling you, when you go down the path of culture and you quit listening and looking to God for your leadership, you will become a person that you thought impossible. And that's exactly what Sarah did. I mean, I'm not just talking about, I'm talking about even in the church. I have seen pastors who felt backed into corners, politically speaking, and they come out fighting in ways that no called man of God should fight. Any of us are susceptible to these inclinations that's in the depths of our sinful hearts. And that's what this holy woman Sarah had done. She went from accusation to abuse, and she was terrifying Hagar, and Hagar could not get her minds off of her. That's the third thing. Your worldly authorities may scare you. And notice what Hagar did when Sarah scared her. Verse 6, so Hagar fled from Sarah's presence. She was a runaway. And that is the natural instinct when our life seems to be a mess, is that we run as far and as fast away from the source of the mess as possible. And often people do that without ever asking God if that's what God wants them to do. I mean, take for instance, a lot of people, when that preacher hurts your feelings, or that deacon or that Sunday school teacher hurts your feelings, what's the first thing that people often do? I go find me another church. Or when your spouse and you, you're at odds with each other, what's the first thing that people do? They begin to threaten. Well, this is going to lead to divorce. And when you begin to threaten running away. When the teenager and the parent are arguing, what's the first thing the teenager always thinks about doing? I mean, every one of you that's grown past your teenage years, you did it, I did it. You think, I'm going to run away from home and get at them. Why does everybody want to run when problems occur? That's the natural instinct of a sin-fallen person. Now, I'm not saying getting away from the source of the problem is always wrong. When Jesus in the Gospels, when he was dealing with the religious leaders, there were times when it was before his hour had come that the confrontation became very intense, and it says that Jesus just basically disappeared. Paul and Barnabas had to separate because of the tension that was so great. Sometimes there are times to depart, and sometimes it's not. So how do you know when to run and when to stay? God's word and intimacy with God in that prayer and meditation and things. You got to look and listen to God to know when to run and when to stay. Life throws some major curveballs. If you look to the world, you look to your family, you think you're smart enough, and you don't look and listen to God, you are going to make a mess of so many things. Just as Abram did, just as Sarah did, just as Hagar did, because she ran. But here's the thing that Hagar learns in this chapter. God was watching the whole time. Here's the truth I want everybody to know. God is looking and listening to you. He sees your problems. He saw what Sarah had done. He saw what Abram had done. He saw what Hagar was having to deal with as Hagar ran away. And what we need to understand is God sees all of us in our problems as well. First characteristic of God that Hagar learns in this chapter is that God sees you where you are. Notice in verse 7, the angel of the Lord found Hagar by a spring of water in the wilderness, by the spring on the way to Shur. Now, Shur is an ancient name for Egypt. Hagar was an Egyptian slave. Probably Abram and Sarah got her when they went down and Abram made a mess the first time. And you remember the Pharaoh gave him all kinds of wealth. They probably got this Egyptian slave at that time, came back up into the Canaanite area. Now Hagar is running back to where she had obviously been a slave before, but she figured it's better to be a slave in Egypt than to be a slave under Sarah. So Hagar is running, and that's when the angel of the Lord appears. Now, in the Old Testament, the angel of the Lord is often the pre-incarnate manifestation of God. Now, what that means, incarnate, that means incarnation. That's when God becomes flesh, when the Holy Spirit overshadows the Virgin Mary, and she conceives in her womb Jesus, that is called the incarnation. All right? Pre means before the Word, Christ, was made permanently incarnate, God would often take on a temporary physical manifestation in order to interact with human beings. And what we've got here, the angel of the Lord, is the pre-incarnate Christ taking on physical manifestation, talking to Hagar. Probably looked, felt like a man. But this is the angel of the Lord. And the angel of the Lord sees Hagar at this spring on the way to Egypt. Now, here's the thing. Who is Hagar? I mean, Hagar is a slave. Strike one. Hagar is a female slave in the patriarchal ancient culture. Strike two. That was not, I mean, ladies, sorry, in that day and time, it was just like a woman was property, just like a slave was property. She was a pagan Egyptian slave in a non-Egyptian household. Strike three. There was no one lower than Hagar. She was the lowest of the low. And yet God saw her. And God cared enough to come to her and talk to her. There is no one in human history that God does not care for them, just as he cared for Hagar. God sees you where you are. But beyond that, God guides you where you should be. Notice in verse 9, the angel of the Lord said to Hagar, return to your mistress and submit yourself under her hand. Now, this is one of the most politically incorrect descriptions in all of the Bible. Think about it. Hagar was a slave. Hagar was a female slave. Hagar was a pagan female slave in a land that didn't belong to her, thus making her an immigrant kind of thing. Feminism, the issue on slavery and prejudice, and the issue of immigration. There's no three bigger subjects in American culture today. And people read this, that your God told this female immigrant slave, go back into her slavery? If that's who your God is, I don't want anything to do with your God. That's how the world thinks. But here's the thing. God is seeing things that the world and we can never see. God, knowing all things, seeing all history and beyond, sees things we cannot see. And more than just having a philosophical, you know, underpinning that determines everything, that's the way the world does it. The best way is to have an intimate relationship with God who sees all and can guide and direct in ways that we cannot do by ourselves. For instance, what if Hagar, who would have been an Egyptian slave already, that's why Pharaoh handed her off in the first place, what if she went back? She's still going to be a slave. What if she went back and she became enslaved to a sex trafficker or something like that? You think Sarah's bad, it could have been a whole lot worse. And only God would know that. Now that's hypothetical, but we know for sure one thing. Had Hagar gone back to Egypt, you know what God she would have been taught and learned? She would have learned the pagan gods of Egypt. There's only one way that Hagar would ever know the one true God. And that is by going back to Abram, where she had plenty of problems, yes. But those problems back there are far less than dying in paganism in the land of Egypt. You see, God's looking at eternity. He's not looking at just in the moment. And when the world looks at a text like this and says, I want nothing to do with that kind of God who will send a female immigrant slave back to her slavery, I'm like, you need to open your eyes and see that God knows a whole lot more than you. That's what faith is. So folks, your worldly authorities, they're going to accuse you, abuse you, and scare you. But God sees you. He guides you, and He promises to bless you. Number three, God blesses you when? When you go where He guides you. Verse 10, then the angel of the Lord said to Hagar, I will multiply your descendants exceedingly. Why was Hagar running? Well, she was running for her own life, but folks, don't forget, she's got a baby in her womb. Any of you mothers who've had babies in your womb, you'll do anything to protect the baby, right? More than likely, Hagar is running, fearful that the physical abuse that Sarah is inflicting upon her may be for the whole purpose of causing her to miscarry. So she's running for her life and her baby's life. And notice, God says, go back, but then He promises that I will multiply your descendants exceedingly. What that tells her is your baby's going to be fine. Go back. You're going to give birth to this baby, and this baby is going to grow into a man and have children and children's children, and there's going to be a vast number of people who are going to descend from you and your baby. That's a promise. But here, I want you to notice one last thing about God's promises. Folks, God speaks honestly about the reality of our lives. Verse 12. God's telling Hagar, He says, but your son, Ishmael, he shall be a wild man. His hand shall be against every man and every man's hand against him. God speaks very plainly of Ishmael, who is Hagar's son by Abram. Said he is going to be a fighter. He is going to be constantly his entire life fighting. And it's not because of the other people. It's because of him. He's the fighter. He's a roughneck and he will never change. And here's the thing. He's promising blessing of this child being okay. That's great. We love your blessings, God. But your blessing isn't going to be everything you hoped it would be. God just speaks straight. He doesn't sugarcoat things. And sometimes He will tell us, look, you want to be saved, put your faith in Jesus. But when you put your faith in Jesus, expect the world to persecute you because they hate Jesus. No sugarcoat there. He just tells us the way it is. Do you trust Him, even when He doesn't sugarcoat life? True people of God trust God, and they will look and listen to Him first and foremost, rather than looking and listen to culture and to family and to the authorities. They will look and listen to God first and foremost. So let me ask you, what do you perceive as your problems in life right now? Financial? The world's got some answers for you, but God does too. Relational, marriage, children, work problems, school problems, neighbor problems, church problems. What do you perceive as some of your biggest problems right now? To whom are you going to be looking for answers? God's answer to Hagar's problem was not an easy answer. But it was the eternal best answer. God's answer to your problems may not be easy, but it will be best in the whole scope of eternity. Do you trust God that much? Maybe to even have to go directly back into the problem, confronting yours and other people's sin, like Abram should have done but didn't. Whatever your problem is, you've got a decision to make. Am I going to do it God's way or some other way?